Hi children, welcome to biology session. In previous session we had discussed about our digestive system, and in digestive system there are different parts are located at their specific places to carry out the special function. In that digestive system we had discussed that how we feel hungry, and also what are the parts are helpful to taste the food. In that mouth, different parts are present. They play a specific role in identifying the taste. We had discussed in that session. In the same manner, we had discussed about our mouth, the munching machine, in detail. The parts are present in the mouth and the teeth present in the mouth. What are the shape of the teeth and what is its function? We discussed in detail. We are going to learn these keywords in this session. Peristalsis, chyme, pyloric sphincter, villi, medulla oblongata, and retropulsion. What is peristalsis? Peristalsis are the wave-like motions performed by the esophagus. Chyme. What is chyme? Chyme is a food where the proteins are digested partially and formed in the stomach. Next, pyloric sphincter. Pyloric sphincter is a one sphincter present in the fundus at pyloric region, which is helpful to send only the small amount of food to the duodenum and sending the back the remaining food towards the fundus. Next, villi. What is villi? Villi are the finger-like projections present in the small intestine, helps in the absorption of products of digestion. Medulla oblongata. Medulla oblongata, which is very familiar to you, you have learned in fifth lesson itself. This is the smallest part of the brain, and the involuntary actions of our body under the control of the medulla oblongata. Next, retropulsion. Retropulsion is a one peristaltic movement shown by the stomach, where only the small amount of food is sent to the duodenum through the pyloric sphincter, remaining the food is sending backwards to the fundus. After swallowing the food enters into the next part of digestive tract, that is esophagus. Okay children, here the esophagus receives the swallowed food, and the esophagus sending that food forward towards the stomach. How it is possible? Here the esophagus is a long tube which is connecting to the pharynx, the upper end, and the lower end of the esophagus is connecting to the stomach. Clear? And the esophagus is a muscular in structure, and also it is elastic in nature. That means it's going to expand according to the food which we take. And also one more characteristic of the esophagus is that the walls of the esophagus secrete the mucus, which is lubricating always this esophagus to forward that bolus which we had made in our mouth. By this mucous membrane, easily through the esophagus, the bolus transported towards the stomach. But how it is pushes downwards? Okay? That is possible by the peristaltic movements performed by the esophagus. What is peristalsis? Peristalsis is a process done by the walls of esophagus, which are wave-like movements. By that wave-like movements, the food easily moves downwards. Clear children? How this esophagus done that peristaltic movements? Here we have an activity to show the model of esophagus, how the bolus moves forward in this esophagus. To perform this activity, first we have to collect some materials. Those are old cycle tubes and two potatoes and coconut oil bottle. First of all, we have to lubricate that old cycle tubes with coconut oil. Simultaneously, smear the coconut oil on potatoes as well. Now, insert one potato in that one cycle tube. Now, push the potato upwards. By pressing the cycle tube, what do you observe? Easily the potato moves downwards when we press. How it is possible? Because of the coconut oil. In the same manner, in our esophagus also, there is a slimy substance secreted from the walls of esophagus to move the bolus forward without any difficulties. And here, what we are doing to that potato? By pressing, we are pushing the potato downwards. In the same manner, our esophagus showing contractions. By this contraction, the potato moves downwards, the bolus moves downwards. In the same manner, the downwards, we are leaving the fingers. Then we are giving gap to move that potato downwards. In the same manner, in esophagus also, that contractions and relaxations are going to perform by the esophagus, and a wave-like motion takes place. By that wave-like motion, the bolus moves forward easily without any inconvenience. By this activity, we can understand that our esophagus showing the peristaltic movements to push the bolus forward. Let us discuss about the peristaltic movements in esophagus. As we already learned that the peristalsis is a wave-like movement performed by the esophagus. But how this esophagus able to perform these wave-like movements? To get clarity, we have to know more about this esophagus. Okay? Let's see here, our walls of esophagus is made up of two kinds of muscles. Inner circular muscles are present in esophagus. Outside, the longitudinal muscles are present. Okay? And these inner circular muscles are gets contracted so that the food pipe is going to become narrower. When the food pipe gets narrower, the bolus pushes downwards. Then what about the longitudinal muscles? These longitudinal muscles present in esophagus gets relaxed. When the circular muscles gets contracted, longitudinal muscles gets relaxed so that the bolus moves easily forward without any difficulties. When these longitudinal muscles gets relaxed, our food pipe is getting widened. Clear, children? But how this relaxation and contraction is done? Means it is one involuntary process, children. It is under the control of autonomous nervous system. As we have already discussed in a fifth lesson in coordination, the linking system. There we have learned the autonomous nervous system is a nervous system which is go on without our control. Okay? Because of this autonomous nervous system, esophagus is going to show the peristaltic movements without our knowing. Look at this picture. Here, we clearly observe the peristaltic movements, the wave-like motions of the esophagus, we can clearly see. There you can see the constricted muscles and relaxed muscle and how the bolus is moving forward in the esophagus towards the stomach, the diagram shows us. Clear? We know that by the peristaltic movements, the bolus moves forward to the stomach. Okay? There, what happens to the bolus? What is happening in the stomach? Let us know more about the stomach. Under the heading, stomach, the mixture and digester. Why the stomach is known as mixture and digester? How the stomach is able to squeeze the food? What helps to the stomach to squeeze the food into smaller substances? How it is possible? Okay, let's see that process. When the food is in the oral cavity, the nerves present in the cheek and tongue. Here, our mouth and cheeks are having some nerve endings. These nerve endings are getting stimulated when the food is in our mouth. Okay? And because of that stimulation, the nerves are generating the impulses. As we know that when the nerves pick up the information, they are going to generate impulses. Then what happens? That impulses is carried through the nerves in the form of chemical signals to the brain. The same thing happens here, that messages are carried to the brain through the sensory neurons. Okay, then the brain analyzes that message and send the message through the motor neurons to the stomach. What message it sends means that the food which is in the mouth, which is next coming to the stomach, there it has to broken down into smaller and smaller components. But how it is possible? The stomach should get ready. That message is sent by the brain to the stomach walls. Then what the stomach walls are doing here? When that message comes from the brain, our walls of the stomach is going to secrete the gastric juices from the gastric glands. In the walls of stomach, there are some glands are embedded. Those glands are called gastric glands, which are going to secrete the gastric juices into the stomach. Okay? And that gastric juice is contained a strong acid which is known as hydrochloric acid. You might have experienced these secretions in the form of belching and in the form of burning. Okay, belching in the sense, sometimes the food in the form of a liquid gets into the mouth and a burning sensation happens in your throat. Okay, that is called belching and burning sensation. In our stomach, we feel some burning sensation when this HCl secreted from the stomach walls. Clear, children? Next, this contraction and relaxations of the stomach muscles is going to squeeze the food. As we know that stomach is a mixture, but how it mix the food? By the contraction and relaxation of the stomach muscles. They are going to squeeze the food and mix the food with gastric juices. And these contractions of the stomach is going to squeeze the food and makes the food mix with the digestive juices and making into that food like smooth porridge like consistency, which is known as chyme. What is chyme? The chyme is a smooth porridge like consistency which made in the stomach by the action of the stomach wall muscles. Okay, now what is happening in the stomach? As we know that digestion starts in the stomach, where the starch is converted into simple sugars. Next, in the part of stomach is going to digest the proteins. In the stomach, the proteins are going to converted into simple molecules like peptones. Okay, in the stomach there are different enzymes acting on the protein substances, making that proteins into smaller substances. Okay, we will discuss in detail about that. First, what is happening in the stomach? The large protein molecules are broken down into smaller molecules. Next, when the digestion process is in the near completion, what is happening means these contraction of the stomach walls are going to decrease. Why it is happening? What makes the stomach muscles to decrease the contractions? There is a substance present in the blood which is glucose. When the glucose levels in the blood are more, that glucose levels in the blood going to regulate the contraction of stomach muscles to decrease. Clear? When the stomach contractions decreases, in stomach there are two sphincters. One is cardiac sphincter and other is pyloric sphincters. This pyloric sphincter is going to open and making a pathway to move that chyme into the small intestine. There is a sphincter. What is that sphincter in the stomach present, children? That is pyloric sphincters. That pyloric sphincters is going to open a pathway to go that chyme into the small intestine in small quantities, not in a total quantity. Only small amount of food is going to enter into the small intestine through these pyloric sphincters. Why this stomach send only small quantities of food? As we know that our stomach is a mixer and digester. Here our stomach helps to mix the food and digest the food. How it is happen means our stomach shows three types of peristaltic movements, which are the propulsion, grinding and retropulsions. First let us know about the propulsion. Propulsion is the first action shown by the stomach. In this action, the food is moving from one part of the stomach to other part. That means from cardiac region to pyloric region, the food moves by this action. Later, the second action takes place, that is grinding. We know that grinding means the food has to be mixed thoroughly. The same thing happens in our stomach by the stomach muscles in the region of pyloric sphincter region. There, by the most vigorous action shown by the stomach, the food is mixed with the digestive juices and makes into smooth porridge-like consistency called chyme, where the proteins have broken down partially. Next, the third movement shown by the stomach, that is retropulsion. In this retropulsion action, only the small quantities of the food moves to the duodenum. The rest of the food is simultaneously pushing back into the stomach. That means only the small amount of food is allowing into the duodenum, rest of the food is pushing backwards by this retropulsion actions. Here the peristalsis movements creates a thrust. That means a pressure is creating. By contraction and relaxation, a thrust created in the esophagus and pushes the food forward through the digestive tract. These peristaltic movements we observe in human beings in clockwise direction. That means it goes from top to bottom. The same peristaltic movements we observe in ruminating animals in anti-clockwise direction. First of all, let us know what are the ruminating animals. The examples for ruminating animals are cow, buffalo, goat, sheep and etc. These animals were known as ruminating animals. Why we call them as ruminating animals means in these animals a special peristaltic movements we observe. That's why they are known as the ruminants. What is that special process? Let us know. In ruminants, they have an extra pouch in the stomach. You might observe while they are grazing, they eat that, they take that grass very fastly and they do not chew it properly. First they swallow that quickly eaten food and store that food in a special pouch in the stomach. From there onwards, next when they are sitting idle, they bring back that quickly swallowed food again into the stomach. Then they chew that food properly by mixing with saliva. This type of process called a rumination. In rumination process, the peristaltic movements occurs in anti-clockwise direction. That means this is a clockwise direction, but in ruminants the peristaltis happens in reverse direction. Understood? But in humans also we find the reverse peristaltis movements. When we found that reverse peristaltic movements? When the humans take the unwanted food without knowing it, our digestive tract will not allow that unwanted food. Then It shows the reverse peristaltic movements and expel that food out of the gut. In that time only in humans we find the reverse peristaltic movements. That means the reverse peristaltic movements is a one protective mechanism in the humans to expel the unwanted food from the gut. We observe that digestion starts in the mouth. There onwards the food moves downwards through the digestive tract and it settles at some places for the digestion. Here is the one table, one information which shows how much time the food retain in that specific places for the digestion process. Look here. Here first let us discuss about the percentage. Here to complete the 50% of the movement or the digestion process to empty the stomach, it takes 2.5 to 3 hours to complete 50% of digestion in the stomach. In the same manner, to complete the small intestine, to move the 50% of food from the small intestine nearly take 2.5 hours. Then how much time to take to complete 100%? Here is the information. To complete, to empty the stomach 100% nearly takes 4 to 5 hours. Then what about small intestine? Nearly take 30 to 40 hours to complete 100% of the food moves from small intestine to the next part. Okay, these are the values just for average. Okay, not exact values. These are the average values taken for the consideration. Here, our stomach is not like a bag with a specific value. That means it is not like a bag. It expands according to the food we take. It is elastic in nature. Clear? It is like a pouch and elastic in nature. Suppose if you take more quantity of food, it's going to expand in its size. If you take less food, it's going to decrease in its size. Okay, that's what I'm saying. It is elastic in nature. Next, it increases in the size according to the food we intake. And here in the stomach, the digestive juices are released. As I have already discussed that different digestive juices are secreted from the walls of stomach, which is aids in the digestion process. But here the digestive juices are produced depending upon the quantity of food which we take. Suppose if you have taken a little quantity of food, the digestive juices also secretes in little quantity. What happens if it happens irrespective of the food which we intake? Our stomach would may destroy. Why it would destroy? We know that our gastric juice are having a strong acid called HCl. The hydrochloric acid is present in the digestive juice, which can digest the hardest bones. That's why our stomach is going to secrete the digestive juices according to the food which we intake. If you take a little quantity, little digestive juices. If you take more quantity of the food, more quantity of digestive juices are going to produce. Clear, children? Our stomach is producing which acid? That is HCl. What is the full form of HCl? Hydrochloric acid, which is the strongest acid which can digest the hard bones as well. We had discussed that a strong acid, that is HCl, secreted from the walls of stomach. Here we are going to perform one activity to know the action of HCl on the walls of stomach. Here for our activity we are taking two green leaves and petroleum jelly and one weak acid we are collecting. And the procedure of this lab activity is, first collect two green leaves. Now take petroleum jelly and apply it on one green leaf and not to the other leaf. In the next step, pour some drops of weak acid on both leaves. Observe. What we will found means the leaf without petroleum jelly is affected by this weak acid, but not the leaf which is applied by the petroleum gel. In the same manner, in our stomach also, there is a mucus secreted by the walls of stomach, which is going to counter the action of the HCl. As we know that our stomach secretes a strong acid, which is known as hydrochloric acid, which is aid in the digestion process and makes the food into acidic nature. We know that in the stomach, the food is going to make like soup-like structure, which is known as chyme. Next, that chyme is going to enter into the next part of digestive tract, which is small intestine. Okay? Now, we will discuss the topic travel of food from stomach to small intestine. When the acidic nature of the chyme leave the stomach, next it enter into the small intestine. The small intestine is a long tube which measures nearly 6.35 meters. It is a highly coiled tube present in the digestive tract, which is the largest part of our digestive tract. What happens when the food enters into the small intestine? The acidic nature of the chyme initiating the production of different hormones in the small intestine. Those hormones are secretin and cholecystokinin. These two hormones are going to stimulate different organs in our digestive tract to produce different digestive juices to complete the digestion process in the small intestine itself. As we know that digestion starts in the mouth and ends in the small intestine. But how the digestion ends? What digestive juices are helped in the completion of the digestion process? Let us discuss. This secretin and cholecystokinin are going to stimulate the pancreas, liver and the walls of small intestine to secrete the pancreatic juice from the pancreas and bile juice from the liver, succus entericus from the walls of intestine. And these pancreatic juice and bile juice and the succus entericus completes the digestion process in the small intestine itself. What are the enzymes present in the pancreatic juice? In the pancreatic juice, we found three enzymes. One is amylase, lipase, trypsin. Already we have discussed that in mouth, there is a partial carbohydrate digestion takes place. And in the stomach, partial protein digestion takes place. And remaining digestion of the carbohydrates and protein digestion takes place in the small intestine with the help of these three enzymes. The amylase is going to act on carbohydrates, lipase is going to act on fats, and trypsin is going to act on proteins, and the digestion completes with the help of these three juices. Next, the liver. The organ liver is secreting juice called bile juice, which is contained no enzyme, which helps in the digestion of fats. We know that our food having different components in it: carbohydrates, fats, vitamins, proteins, and these are going to break down into smaller and smaller substance. That is called digestion, right? By this liver, the fats are going to digest. Next, from the walls of small intestine, the succus entericus is going to secrete. This succus entericus is also aids in the digestion process. Finally, the digestion completes in the small intestine. As we know that the digestion completes in the small intestine. What happens after the digestion here? We know our small intestine is a highly coily tube and which measures nearly 6.35 meters. Here, the inner surface of the small intestine is having the tiny finger-like projections. Those are known as villi. Villi is a plural word. Villus is a singular word. Okay. What is the function does by the villus in the small intestine? This villi helps in the absorption of nutrients. We know that the digestion process completes in the small intestine itself. Now, that products of digestion are going to be absorbed into the blood circulation by this structure called villi. And this absorption process is a active process. You might studied these processes in 9th class. There are two processes, that is active process and passive process. In passive process, the substances moves from high concentration to low concentration. In active process, the substances are going to move from active, though they have more products in the blood, then also this absorption process continues in the small intestine. Okay, that's why here I am mentioning that it is a selective process. Understood? Here, what is the one more function done by this villi means, the villi increases the surface area for absorption process. Here, in the small intestine, the food has to be retained for longer time. How can the food retain for longer time means, we find the small tiny finger-like projections which are going to obstruct the food and retain the food for longer time for absorption process. In this way, the villi increases the surface area for absorption of the products of digestion. Look at the structure. The villus is made with a single layer epithelial cells, and also it is composed with a capillary network as well as the lymphatic duct. Through this single layer epithelial cells, that products of digestion are going to easily diffused into the circulatory system, which means diffuses into the capillary network. There onwards, that products are going to transported through the blood circulation to all parts of the body, and there next the utilization of food takes place. That we will discuss in the next moment. And also next, lacteal duct also we find in the small intestine. This is the structure of villi. In villus, the circulatory system and the lymphatic system works together in the absorption of the products of digestion. And there onwards, that will carried out to the all parts of the cell, and there the final utilization of the food takes place. Today's worksheet, look at how many kinds of muscles present in esophagus. What is peristalsis? What stimulates stomach muscles into action? What?